house in its water. And I looked up Canada, that's 280 parts per million. So you're better than the US, but you're much worse than Europe. And 11,900 parts per million is what was found in genetically modified soybeans. So there's where we sit. And so Zen Honeycutt is the hero of my work. She comes up from Moms Across America. She founded Moms Across America, and she's been measuring glyphosate and various things. And she found levels in human breast milk from Americans who were being relatively conscientious about avoiding GMOs, 1,600 times higher than the level upper limit allowed in the water in Europe. Glyphosate in cotton products, this was quite shocking to me, but maybe not surprising, because cotton is a GMO crop. Some researchers in Argentina were just wanted to use these cotton products as a baseline against some experiment they were doing. They thought, well, let's just go get the baseline measure, expecting it to be zero. And they were shocked to find that 85% of the products that they tested had significant levels of glyphosate in them, including tampons and sterile cotton gauze. You can think about Pampers, baby diapers. In 2014, 96% of cotton produced in the United States was genetically modified to resist glyphosate. So you have to worry about the clothing your children are wearing. Maybe that's why they have eczema. We have an epidemic in eczema right now. So is glyphosate toxic? Monsanto says no. It's a great product because it works on this pathway called the shikimate pathway, which humans don't have that pathway in their cells, so good, we're great, we don't have to worry about it. But there's a big consideration there, which is that our gut bacteria do have this pathway, and they use it to make really important products that we need because we can't make them. Things like the aromatic amino acids, which are precursors to all the neurotransmitters, as well as folate, so the dopamine and serotonin, melatonin, melanin, the skin tanning agent, all of these things are derived from the shikimate pathway. So they're going to be deficient if our microbes can't make it, and furthermore, our microbes are not going to be able to do well, so it kills off the beneficial bacteria and allows the pathogens to gain a foothold in the gut and ends up with a lot of gut problems. Also, Roundup is not just glyphosate. There's other products in there. First of all, they add salts to make the glyphosate more soluble, and then they also add surfactants that allow the glyphosate to get into the cell and also are in and of themselves toxic. So the Roundup is much more toxic than the glyphosate, pure glyphosate, which is what they studied in the lab. And furthermore, glyphosate's effects are insidious, so you don't immediately notice that you're being poisoned. It takes time for the poison to develop into a point where you start to see symptoms. And they made a rule that you only have to study for 3 months, and lots of times the problems don't show up until 4 months. So here's some of the main toxic effects. One thing that we noted from Anthony Sampson and I, by the way, wrote this paper in 2013 in Entropy, and this one was when my first paper on glyphosate. And we found literature that shows that it interferes with the function of these very important enzymes in the liver called cytochrome P450 enzymes. I'll talk a bit more about them later. It also chelates a lot of minerals that are really important for our enzymes. Many of our enzymes depend on enzymes as minerals as catalysts, and glyphosate holds on to those minerals and won't let them go, and so it messes up the whole way that the body transports those minerals, and it can actually release them and cause the mineral to be toxic. So these minerals are very need to be managed very carefully because they can be toxic if they're in the wrong place at the wrong time. And glyphosate makes it very difficult for the body to manage them correctly. I mentioned the aromatic amino acids, and also methionine, which is at the base of the sulfur pathway, is also disrupted by glyphosate. And that leads to shortages in the neurotransmitters as well as folate. And it disrupts sulfate synthesis and sulfate transport. And I've identified sulfate deficiency as a key driver behind most modern diseases. I talk a lot about that in my research. So the central mechanism, it acts as an antibiotic to disrupt the gut bacteria, letting the pathogens overgrow. It disrupts the CYP enzymes. That leads to both impaired bile flow and low vitamin D, because you need the CYP enzymes to activate the vitamin D. And you also need the CYP enzymes to detoxify many other toxic chemicals in the environment. So it makes other chemicals more toxic than they would otherwise be because you can't break them down. And also messes up sulfate synthesis and sulfate transport. It damages the red blood cells. This has been shown in some of the studies that I've been reading. And that leads to anemia. We have an epidemic in anemia worldwide. And it also leads at the same time to toxicity due to the free iron that's released by these damaged red blood cells. You get hypoxia, low oxygen, because the red blood cells need the iron to carry the oxygen. And then you get into a low-grade encephalopathy, and you get into a leaky brain, and you can get other dangerous metals like aluminum and mercury getting into the brain and causing trouble. So evidence of toxicity, I mentioned the Cyp enzymes. This was a study done in 1983 where they looked at several different chemicals. 2,4-D is another herbicide, clofibrate, MCPA, and glyphosate. And they looked at the Cyp enzyme activity in the liver of the rats, and they found only glyphosate, the control is on the left, and glyphosate, you can see, drastically reduced the activity of the Cyp enzymes, whereas some of the other ones actually increased their activity. Glyphosate was by far the worst. And this is going to affect the bees. You know, we have an epidemic in a crisis in the bees in America and elsewhere in the world. They need those Cyp enzymes to detoxify the neonicotinoids, and everyone's saying the neonicotinoids are the problem with the bees, but if glyphosate's also in the mix, then the neonics become much more toxic. Minerals I mentioned, and so this shows, this is some data from Don Huber, one of my personal heroes. He was really the first person that I learned about, where I learned about the toxicity of glyphosate. And he has here the minerals iron, manganese, and zinc, and he shows the roots and going up into the shoots of the plant. And the control is the green at the reference pool level. So you can see tremendous reduction in manganese in the roots and even more in the shoots. And the other ones are also all down here in the shoots. These minerals are going to be deficient in the food you eat, which is going to lead to personal deficiencies as well, human deficiencies. And I've written a lot, Anthony and I have a whole paper on the manganese problem. So we'll say a little bit more about that here. This is a plot from a paper by Margaret Kruger et al. This is the minimum that you would expect for manganese in the blood from cows, and this is the maximum, this is the range that you would expect. These are 8 different farms, and on all the farms, the levels were well below the minimum expected level. Same thing for cobalt. Cobalt was practically non-existent in the blood in these cows, and these cows were all testing positive for glyphosate in their urine, so they're suspecting the glyphosate is preventing them from getting enough manganese. Manganese deficiency causes a lot of problems, and I think it's connected to autism. I can see direct connections to things that are associated with autism. They include lactobacillus, which is the microbe that needs to really get a stronghold in the gut when it first starts, when you first start after you're born. And they critically depend on manganese. They use manganese in ways that other microbes don't, and so they're going to be harmed, and that's what's going to set you off with a wrong balance of microbes in the gut. Manganese superoxide dismutase is essential for protecting the mitochondria from damage. Mitochondria are the source of the ATP, the energy source of the cell. Manganese is also essential for detoxifying glutamate, which is a neurotoxin. So, and autistic kids have high glutamate. Lots of evidence of high glutamate in autism. It'll burn out the neurons in the brain if you can't, get rid of it through the manganese. And the pituitary depends on manganese to release thyroid-stimulating hormone. So if the pituitary is manganese deficient, you're going to have low thyroid, and we have a lot of issues with low thyroid. Chondroitin sulfate synthesis in the bones depends upon manganese, and that means that the bones will be sick as well. This was a paper on the adjuvants, which was really quite surprising to me that they claimed that up to 1,000 times more toxicity for something like Roundup compared to glyphosate because of the adjuvants in the pesticides. And this is true more generally for the other pesticides as well. And then they had this lovely quote, it's commonly believed that Roundup is among the safest pesticides. Despite its reputation, Roundup was by far the most toxic among the herbicides and insecticides tested. And this inconsistency between scientific fact and industrial claim may be attributed to huge economic interests, of course it is, which have been found to falsify health risk assessments and delay health policy decisions. So this is really a huge problem that we face. A very toxic chemical, pervasive in our environment, very carelessly monitored, and we're all thinking that it's fine, so it's very scary. This is an article by Cerolini et al. Studying rat exposure, and this was really, I thought this was the only experiment that had been done for the full lifespan of the animals. It turns out that Monsanto has done some early experiments, but they buried them and made them secret, and so we weren't really aware of them. But Cerolini found massive mammary tumors in the rats that were exposed to low environmental levels of glyphosate of Roundup throughout their lifespan. He didn't see any problems after 3 months, but at 4 months he started to see issues. And by the end of the life, he found a lot of problems in both the males and females. We had the mammary tumors in the females. The males had increased risk of liver and kidney disease. Sex hormone was disrupted in both the males and females, and he saw enhanced oxidative stress. And so, as I said, the effects started to appear at 4 months. So if you quit at 3 months, you don't see anything. This is a paper that I really like. Nancy Swanson is a friend of mine, and she published this paper with these other colleagues called Genetically Engineered Crops, Glyphosate, and the Deterioration of Health in the United States of America. And she has something like over 30 figures in that paper. And I'll just show you a few of them, and we'll show some more later on when they become appropriate. But these are all figures showing all these diseases that are going up dramatically in the United States in step with the dramatic increase of Roundup. So we have thyroid cancer, diabetes, end-stage renal disease, kidney disease, and urinary bladder cancer. These are just some examples from her paper. And in all cases, you see very strong. The red is the glyphosate, and the blue is the usage of the Roundup Ready crops. Oops. So many of you probably know the WHO declared glyphosate a probable carcinogen in 2015, and that has kind of stirred up a lot of trouble in the regulatory process. So in Nancy's paper, they said, although correlation does not necessarily mean causation, when correlation coefficients of over 0.995 with p-value significance levels less than 0.00001, are calculated for a list of diseases that can be directly linked to glyphosate by its known biological effects, it would be imprudent not to consider causation as a plausible explanation. I'm certainly doing that. And so what I've been doing is to try to understand how could glyphosate be causing these things? What could be the underlying biological mechanism that would do that? I want to have one more here on antibiotic resistance, which is a very serious concern of mine. As you probably know, we have a lot of issues with our multiple resistant microbes in the hospitals causing people to die. They go in for some innocent operation, they end up dead because they pick up an infection in the hospital and you can't kill it. You give them every antibiotic you can think of. Glyphosate can make that happen because it teaches the microbes how to flush out the toxins, not just glyphosate, but other antibiotics that come their way. It gives them a general solution to flush them out and keep their levels low so that the microbes can still live. And that also helps to enable the pathogens to get into the host cells. And so that's, I think, could be a major factor in the epidemic that we're seeing in antibiotic resistance. Okay, so now my major topic here, glyphosate and proteins, new topic. You guys are among the first to hear about this, so I'm excited, and I hope you will be too. What's the concept? Well, glyphosate could be inserting itself during protein synthesis, directly when you're making the protein. And I don't know how many of you have enough biology to know about proteins being made as the beads on a string. You have the 20 or so basic amino acids, and those are the coding amino acids. You have the DNA code. So for example, GGC here codes for glycine. They're building the protein from the DNA sequence, and they say, okay, we need a glycine. They grab a glycine. So this is not a glycine. This is a glyphosate. But this part is glycine. It's got something stuck onto the nitrogen, but otherwise it's glycine. And so the system could be confused and could put this in there instead of glycine. And if it does that, it is huge. It has huge effects everywhere. So there's your glyphosate, and it goes in instead of glycine into the protein. And this will mess up the way this protein behaves and prevent it from doing its job correctly, and also cause the protein to resist being broken down. So it's a really bad scene, because you make a protein that doesn't work, and then usually you would just, okay, break it down, make it again. But you can't do that because it'll make it, because glyphosate makes it hard to break it down as well. So you accumulate this protein debris that can cause a lot of damage to your cells. And so I said that glyphosate is a synthetic, non-coding amino acid analog of glycine. And so I started looking at the research literature to find out, well, what are some of the proteins that absolutely require glycine in their particular point in order to work properly? Where is the glycine critically at the active site, et cetera? There's a lot of papers on this. It's very fascinating. And I can see then, oh my God, that's all these diseases that are going up in step with glyphosate. So you can find, and I'm going to go into more detail about not all of these, because obviously we are short on time, but many of these I will talk more about in a moment. But I can, and this is where the new paper that's coming out with Anthony and me talks about all of these conditions, neurological diseases, neural tube defects, celiac disease. Collagen has huge amounts of glycine, and collagen, of course, is in the joints. And so we have a huge problem with joint problems today. Many people have problems with their joints, their rheumatoid arthritis. If the collagen's got glyphosate in it, you're going to be in trouble. It won't form its proper crystalline form, and then it will also then not be able to be broken down and resynthesized. So fatty liver disease, obesity, adrenal insufficiency, impaired iron homeostasis, which can lead to kidney failure, and we're seeing kidney failure among the agricultural workers in multiple places around the world, in Central America and in Sri Lanka and in India. They're finding kidney failure for